Ladies and gentlemen, may I please ask you to rise and remove your hats for the singing of O Canada, followed by the Lord's Prayer. We call to order the meeting for Wednesday, February 10. Heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, Council, and we begin today's meeting with the customary approval of the agenda, with the customary additions and deletions and changes. So if I could have your attention, I believe you have a copy of the agenda approval motion, but to be saying it out loud, it is moved by Councillor Dillon and seconded by Councillor Miles. The agenda is a position to be approved with the following changes. First, there are two deletions, deleting delegations G1 and G2 have both requested to be deleted. There is one addition, that would be G3. Mr. Joel Barber has requested to speak on item I85 and correspondence L2, so that is an additional delegation who is speaking to a matter before this council. Pardon me, the deletion of G1 was Neil Monkman with respect to report I8-6, Mount Pleasant Secondary Plan. And the deletion of G2 is Mr. Davis and Mr. Cutrizola with respect to the John Street, James Street intersection. There are two pieces of correspondence to be added. Mr. Farber has brought a piece of correspondence that needs to be officially added as L2. And Mr. Don Naylor, the chair of the Downtown Development Corporation, has issued a piece of correspondence to be before us in relation to item K1. There's also an additional item, P1, under new business. Councillor Moore would like to add the subject, general process procedures, re-dog seizure and dog owners liability act. And then there are three bylaws to add and an item for closed session. Are there any questions? Oh, and there are two announcements to add. Another announcement will be known as E2. And it's for Councillor Dillon and his upcoming trip to Haiti. And announcement E3, which is about a seniors' fair, and Councillor Miles will make that announcement. So those need to be added onto here, E2 and E3. Councillor Miles, you okay? Okay. All those in favor of the agenda as added, deleted, and modified. All those in favor, hands up. That's carried. Thank you very much, Council. Before we begin, we are on the eve of the 2010 Olympic Games. As you know, Brampton was a host community to the torch relay connecting Bramptonians to this very exciting event commencing Friday in Vancouver, concluding Friday, February 28th. And Brampton has three Olympians who are participating in this year's Olympic Games, so feel that additional connection when you're watching the women's hockey play. Co-captain of the women's Olympic team, Bramptonian Brampton Thunder player Jaina Hefford, and another member of the women's gold Olympic, I shouldn't say gold, sorry, past gold Olympic team, Ms. Jillian Apps, who also plays with the Brampton Thunder, granddaughter of Sil Apps, and of course, Apps Transport, who I'm sure moved to Brampton because we were so supportive of women's hockey. And the, of course, the superstar, Rick Nash, who will be playing with the men's Olympic team. So Brampton will be cheering on behalf of council and all the residents of Brampton. We're cheering Go Canada Go, and let's really enjoy a good set of games. Council, moving to the next item on the agenda, conflicts of interest. Do we have any conflicts of interest to declare? Seeing none, we now move to the minutes of the regular meeting, and the minutes have been moved by Councillor Gibson and Moore, and they are to be approved with replacement pages 13 to 18, which were distributed prior to the meeting. So the replacement pages corrected are now part of the minutes. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor? Thank you. That's carried. Council, we now move to the consent agenda. This is the series of decisions that are ready to be approved by the fact of a consent motion, which bundles them all together. However, if any member of council wants to add to or subtract from for further discussion, this is the time to do so. Councillor Gibson.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Now that we have the delegation G1 not speaking on this item, and I know there's a lot of people in the audience that have been involved in this item I-8-6. I'd like to, Councillor Hutton and I have spoken, and as area councillor, Councillor Hutton is going to move, and I will second the report and move it in consent unless there's questions from council. But before I do that, I just want to say a couple words, and they are to our staff and to the development community. Councillor Pelleschi and myself, as chair and vice chair of planning, have spent I don't know how many hours on this with staff and the development community, and I can't say that I could say that I don't think there's ever been something in planning that's taken so much time and so much precision and so much enthusiasm to get something done as this. And I think this is going to be a tremendous community around the Mount Pleasant Village. And Commissioner, please send council's thanks to the rest of to yourself and to all the staff that are involved, and to the development community, thank you very much for the hard work that you've also been putting into this, because it's been a long road, but it's been a very, very successful road, I think, in the end of this. So I'd like to, or Councillor Hutton and myself would like to put it, move it and put it into consent, unless there's any questions from the rest of council.
I've added it to the consent agenda, Councillor. No other changes to the consent agenda then. All those in favor? Thank you. That's carried. There's the consent agenda, and that's the added item. I'd like to echo the comments of Chair Gibson about the Mount Pleasant project. I think this is the most significant decision we'll be making, without question, today about a modern form of development, environmentally sustainable, transit friendly. It just does everything right. And by moving it into consent, we don't see the volume of work that's been done, recipient of economic stimulus funding, funding partners with the private sector. An extraordinary job has been done here to put a Brampton community on the map as the poster child for proper planning in Ontario. In fact, Councillor Gibson, I know the Premier made that statement when he saw the first renderings of how this community, that's what took the City of Brampton to the World Leadership Forum as having the best planning and planning modern of our time, and we won for North America because of the creativity and partnership on this modern plan. I look forward to the day when all of the legal papers are signed following this decision, which has just been made, and that we can do a full expose on the important groundbreaking work that has been done by this staff team and this council and the development community and the public as we've brought forward the modern way to manage growth, our Brampton, our future. Thank you to everyone. Councillor Hutton, did you want to make a comment as well?
Very briefly, Madam, just to echo your words, our planning staff and on occasion the development community has had bad press and in the past, but I think this is a wonderful example of what happens when good developers and good planning staff, great planning staff, get together and come up with what's going to be maybe the greatest community in all of Canada. Looking forward to it.
Thank you very much. Council, we now move to the announcement portion of the agenda, and I'd like to ask Roberta Kenning, who's our Supervisor of Programs for Community Services, to come forward, and I don't have to say make an enthusiastic announcement because she's enthusiastic every minute of every day. Welcome, Roberta.
To tell you about a wonderful festival and idea for you to do on Family Day, Monday, February the 15th at the Donald M. Gordon Chincoosi Park. We are going to have fun outside. So we're inviting everyone here and residents of Brampton to come to Ching Park, as well as any other community center, and the people behind me will tell you a little bit about that. But we've got live entertainment, we've got roasting marshmallows, we've got fun family activities, and I brought some friends from the park with me today. And these guys are our little penguins suspended in ice, and they will be at the park on Winterfest, so we invite some kids to come on out and come get your little ice cube, and you can chop away and get at your little penguin. We've got cupcake decorating and skiing, snowboarding, and of course tubing. And we're offering 3-hour lift pass on Monday the 15th for, so you pay for a 3-hour lift pass and you can use it all day. Oh. So we got wonderful stuff going on. If you look in your recreation centers, you'll see these posters and flyers, and they'll tell you a little bit more about the day and how to get in contact with us if you have any questions. We've got some amazing live entertainment, and Eugene is going to talk to us about that.
Mayor Fennell, members of council, it's with great pleasure that I inform you that the mayor's youth team will be responsible for the main stage entertainment at the Brampton Winter Festival. The mayor's youth team in the past month has done a number of things to build up this event, from recruiting amazing talent, anything from dance crews, singers, speakers, and so forth, in relation to Family Day, as well as the promotion and marketing. And so the youth of Brampton are very excited. The team is very excited. And I encourage all of you, if you are available on Family Day, to come check out the main stage, as again, there will be a number of great youth talent in the city of Brampton. Thanks.
I could just add that Carl Wolf will be there from 4 to 5, who's a very popular singer right now. Performer. Thanks.
Madam Mayor, members of council, my name is Bill Grant, and together with my teammate Amy Ouellette, we're pleased to let you know that our community development team has been working with the recreation centers throughout the city of Brampton, who will be offering drop-in programs on Family Day. Programs include swimming, skating, shinny hockey, and a family fitness program, as well as a variety of other activities that they can drop in and enjoy at our recreation centers. All the activities are listed on brampton.ca, and we're looking forward to welcoming the residents of Brampton. Thank you.
My mic on? I just wanted to say to Roberta, I saw you on TV the other day. You did a tremendous job. Promoting morning to Ski Hill with Jennifer from the City TV. So I just wanted to say, good job, well done.
Thank you. I have to say that Mount Chincoosee is one of her favorite places to go. She really enjoys the skiing and the tubing.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to keep up to Jennifer when she's so bubbly, but you did a tremendous job.
It's on the fly.
Keep it up there. She was great, and so were you. Thank you.
Thank you.
For coming and telling us about the great family day plan. Of course, it's a 3-day weekend, and we have lots of events in our great city, our city of Brampton, for families, free family events, and just going to be a great time. So thank you for coming and sharing all of the details. We hope we have snow and the good weather, not too cold, so the outdoor events are pleasant to enjoy. And you have a band playing as well on family day.
We do. Three's Company. They're members of Decadence, and they'll be opening up for Carl Wolf, as well as at 1 o'clock they'll be performing too. And they're a huge hit with Brampton.
Yeah, that's
everybody
just great.
Enjoys their performance.
Thank you for that. Okay, thanks for that announcement. And just as a reminder, Brampton Transit will be providing its standard all-day service on Monday, February 15th. So for any young people who want to get out to the park, you don't need to get a lift. You can hop on Brampton Transit, bring your snowboard or your skis, and enjoy coming to the park and spending the day. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Council, the next announcement is one that we added, and I'm very, very proud to make this announcement. Our Councillor Dillon has been invited as part of a UN participation in the needs for Haiti, and will be traveling to Haiti this Sunday, February 14th, on Valentine's Day. Councillor Dillon has a full container that has been organized, and here's why we can help Councillor Dillon. He can fill this container. It's not carry-on, it's way too big. It's a full container, and he will be accompanying this container to Haiti. And this is what he's been asked to see if he can fill the container with. They have said children's clothing, very needed. Children's clothing, toothbrushes, toothpaste, knapsacks, any dry wrapped food, socks, plastic shoes. So those are the items, let me say them again. Children's clothing, toothbrushes, toothpaste, knapsacks. You could put them all in a knapsack and donate a knapsack with these items. Dry wrap food, socks, plastic shoes, and here's how the city's going to support Councillor Dillon. You can drop these items off to your local recreation center, Commissioner Lowry, and we only have a few days to get it all into one place over to this container, and Councillor Dillon will be bringing these items personally to Haiti. Thank you. Councillor Dillon, did you want to say a word? And then Councillor Callahan.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I just want to say thanks to all the council members and our staff for the support and encouragement, especially to Dennis Kutajar. He's providing me T-shirts, the logo of City of Brampton, Brampton Cares Haiti. And I'm so thankful to our staff. And I just want to say, residents, people need their summer clothes, not winter clothes in Haiti. It's already warm there. I find out there are thousands of kids are homeless, they lost their parents, and especially I'm taking personally myself 1,500 T-shirts for those kids, the logo of City of Brampton, and I want everyone to donate extra clothes in our rec centers, wherever they can, we can collect from there. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Callahan.
Madam Mayor, I think it's admirable that he's going there, but I still get back to the comment made by a fellow I don't appreciate, George W. He said they need money. I really don't understand what, well, let me ask this. You say that he was invited by the UN. This is the first thing I've heard of the UN inviting anybody. Is there some indication of a letter from the UN or something telling us that he's been invited?
Councillor Callahan, I think this is something that's been arranged independently with Councillor Dillon, not by the city.
I don't.
Oh, okay.
The UN is attached with different community, like Salvation Army, United Sikhs, and all the Red Cross. They are working with UNO, and they don't allow any person to go straight to Haiti. If you want to go, then you have to get permission from UNO to go to Haiti, and I got permission through by the United Nations organization to visit there, help the people there.
Well, I wish you luck. I would love to go too, but I'm only a lawyer. I don't know what I'd be able to do there, and I'm not a doctor. If I were a doctor, I'd be down there in a heartbeat. I don't understand this, but good luck.
Thank you very much, Councillor Dillon. The next announcement, Councillor Miles, you want to tell us about a seniors' fair.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll be brief. I just wanted to put this announcement out that North Bramley United Church are holding a seniors' fair, and it's kind of unique. It's called Everything You Want to Know But Didn't Know Who to Ask. And so they've got a full day for seniors. So seniors can go and ask questions on basically anything that they have, whether it's to do with the city, their community, leisure activities, health, wellness, housing, finances, etc. And it's being held on February 23rd at North Bramley United Church. So if anyone wants more information, they can certainly contact North Bramley United Church, or they can contact me at my office. But there are going to be posters around the community, and programs for the day are available as well. Thank you, Madam Mayor. February 23rd. Starts at 10 a.m. and runs to 3 p.m.
Okay. Thank you very much. We now move to proclamations, and Tim Sturgeon, Area Commissioner of Brampton Area Scouts, is here. If you could come forward, I'm very proud to make this proclamation as an honorary scout. Whereas the mission of scouts and guides is the education of young people through a value system based on their promise and law, and whereas Girl Guides of Canada and Boy Scouts of Canada help build a better world where people are self-fulfilled as individuals and play a constructive role in society, and whereas 2010 marks 103 years of helping boys and girls become better citizens, therefore I, Mayor Susan Fennell, do hereby proclaim the week of February 21 through 28, 2010 to be Scout Guide Week in the City of Brampton. It's dated today, it's corporate sealed, and perhaps I can pass it to the Deputy Clerk to pass to you. Welcome, would you like to say a few words?
Grateful for the cooperation and the support the city has given all of our members of scouting throughout the years, and we look forward to that continued support in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Proud to have the scouts and guides doing so well here in Brampton. Thanks to all the volunteer leaders.
Yes.
Thank you.
Very much.
Council, we now are moving to delegations, and the one delegation who is added is Mr. Joel Farber, and the item is I-85. Perhaps we could bring that forward to the meeting, and the motions that are before me, just so Council knows, are to receive the report and to approve the recommendation in the, is Mr. Farber here? Oh, there you are. Please come forward. Thank you.
Members of Council, thank you for allowing me to make this delegation to you today. I've submitted a letter on behalf of our client, RioCan Real Estate Investment Trust, the owner of the Shoppers World Brampton Mall. The city is not entitled to enact an interim control bylaw because of subsection 38.7 of the Planning Act. The board has repealed the prior bylaw, and no further bylaw may be enacted for a period of 3 years. I'm here to answer any questions you might have about that correspondence. And that's all of my submissions.
Thank you. There are none on the board. Therefore, I have a motion to, pardon me, Councillor Callahan. Did you just push your button?
Yes, sorry. I did. This is the RioCan?
Correct, sir.
What, as I understand it, and of course we don't have any words from on high, we don't have a decision yet, but that it was declared ultra-virus. And I don't see anything in that that would prevent us from now passing a new bylaw. What's your authority for that?
The authority is the clear language of the Planning Act, which says where the bylaw ceases to be in effect, a new bylaw can't be passed for 3 years. The bylaw clearly was in effect, given that the bylaw was only repealed by the Ontario Municipal Board.
Well, no, but if it was ultra-virus from the start, it didn't exist.
That is incorrect, sir.
Well, why is that incorrect?
Because the board was not asked to and did not declare the bylaw as having never been in effect. The board repealed the bylaw. In other words, it was in effect. It clearly was in effect. The board granted an exemption for other properties. Our client was itself bound by the interim control bylaw until such time as the board found that it was not in conformity with the Planning Act. So the suggestion that it was not in effect is incorrect in law.
Well, the board said that because the city tried to control the height of buildings for a very good purpose, a bona fide purpose, that was outside of the authority of the city, and they declared it ultra-virus. If something's declared ultra-virus, well, my humble opinion, doesn't exist from day one. So there never was an interim control bylaw with reference to your client, and therefore the city has every right to enact a new interim control bylaw. I'd like to hear from our staff in that regard, Madam Mayor. This is a very critical issue in terms of the...
If I just might answer...
I think we've heard your position that you think it's inappropriate. The staff report is recommending it, so I'm going to allow staff to respond to the councillor's question, and then we'll move on. Thank you.
I'm happy to answer that question, Madam Mayor. Mr. Farber is stressing the point that the bylaw was repealed, and I would point out that our information, we don't have reasons for decision, but our information that I take from Mr. Farber's notice of motion before the board was, quote, RioCan is therefore entitled to a declaration that the ICBL is ultra-virus, that's outside the city's jurisdiction, and an order allowing its appeal. So asking the board to declare the matter ultra-virus is exactly what RioCan asked for, and And that goes to Councillor Callahan's point. It is a technical legal point. It seems that Mr. Farber is hanging on his hat on the words repealed, but that, in my understanding of the case, is not what he asked the board to do and not what the board did.
All right, can I inquire, would it be wise for us to have a copy of the wording of the decision before we make any decision?
Madam Mayor, in response to the councillor's question, we would love to have a copy of the reasons for decision. We don't have those. So right now we're in a position where the board has orally struck down the bylaw. There is no bylaw protecting a very important planning zone in the city. In good faith, the city staff is recommending to pass a bylaw to protect the city from that based on the information we have to date.
Thank you.
So in other words, to pass it now to protect our interests. It turns out that Mr. Farber's ingenious argument is correct, then we are in a different position.
Madam Mayor, if information does change, then we would, of course, report that to Council.
All right. And then the staff report is then to enact an interim control bylaw.
Councillor, you've seconded that motion, yes?
Yes, I'm in favor.
Okay, so it's moved by Councillor Sanderson and Councillor Callahan. Oh, sorry, Councillor Moore.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch Councillor Callahan's last comments.
The staff is asking that we enact a bylaw, an interim control bylaw. Mr. Farber is saying we can't do it. The argument that's being made is that because it was outside of our jurisdiction, the interim control bylaw never existed. Therefore, it's like it never happened.
I understood what the delegation was saying.
Right.
So you are in support of enacting the
through
bylaw.
Through the chair, please.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Chair.
Yes.
Supporting the enacting of the bylaw. I guess the only question that I have through you, Madam Mayor, to staff is, in the absence of having the ruling in writing, and I understand that we have a verbal ruling, what are the consequences of enacting or dealing with the report today
in the absence of having the ruling in writing. I think, please, through the chair, this report is to position an interim control bylaw to protect this very large property for proper zoning and architectural controls and all of the things we subscribe to in the gateway. So this is saying, place this interim control bylaw and use whatever tools
Madam
you
Mayor,
have, city, to improve what is being done here.
I understand the purpose of the interim control bylaw. I'm asking specifically, what are the consequences of dealing with the interim control bylaw today? I understand the intent of it, and I understand, I mean, it's the right thing to do. I'm trying to understand what the consequences are of dealing with that today in the absence of having the ruling from the Ontario Municipal Board in writing.
Well, I think it's good
I'm trying to understand our legal staff. Because our legal staff has said, if the ruling is given to us in writing and it says that then it could be challenged what we do today. And that's what I'm trying to understand in terms of consequences. If we pass the, if we put through the interim control bylaw today, which is, in my view, what we want to do on this corridor, and then there is an issue of interpretation subsequent to today, how does this municipality deal with that?
And the solicitor
scenario?
Said if the information is different than what he's been verbally told, he then has to report back to council. That question was answered three questions ago.
That's correct, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. So I have the motion here for receipt of the report and the support of the staff recommendation as moved by Councillor Callahan and seconded by Councillor Sanderson. All those in favor? Thank you. That's carried. Thank you. Next item is? Oh, Councillor Gibson, planning chair, the minutes of planning. And then Councillor Sanderson, you're up for Committee of Council. Councillor Gibson.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Council, you have minutes of the planning, last planning meeting in front of you. Are there any questions or comments?
Seeing none.
Seeing none, I pass them back to you for ratification.
Thank you. All those in favor of the minutes of planning? Thank you. That's carried. The minutes of Committee of Council. Councillor Sanderson.
Okay, you have before you the minutes of the Committee of Council meeting. Any questions?
None on the board.
All in favor?
All those in favor of the minutes of Committee of Council? That's carried. Thank you. Council, the next item on the agenda is item K1. That is the report that I asked to be referred to this meeting because we had an idea. So I would ask that we bring N1 forward to deal with N1 first so that the K1 has a funding solution. Can we do that? Will council agree to bring N1 forward? All in favor? Got to do this right? Majority rules? Thank you. Council, we're now then dealing with N1. N1 is a notice of motion that I filed properly before the clerk. You have read it. It's to reopen a previous council resolution. The rules of notices of motion say that I must restrict my comments to simply the item that is being reopened and not get into the why. If it's reopened, of course, the why will follow, but those are the rules. So I'd just like to recap. It's been presented here in the whereases, and I recall in 2008, council recall at the AMO meeting that the premier made an announcement for all Ontario municipalities called Invest Ontario. It was a one-time funding that was put forward on a formula which delivered a particular amount of funding to every municipality as a one-time fund for or infrastructure needs or whatever you felt you wanted to do. It was not expected, it wasn't planned for. It was a nice surprise announcement because we were waiting for the uploading announcement of social services and pooling. That wasn't ready at AMO. This announcement came instead. This announcement originally delivered $13 million plus dollars to the city of Brampton, and then there was a revised calculation and it came up to just over $16 million. Council, the reason I'm asking, and we approved a series of projects that were unfunded, that we always wanted to get done but didn't have the money to do. And what I'm asking council to do, I've done my homework, of some of the capital projects that we had listed had not yet been started. And as it says in the notice of motion, the John James Street is also in the downtown, and in my view, there's a preferred design that would be an improvement to the downtown. So I asked the question of staff, if there's a line item in that Invest Ontario fund where the dollars have not yet been spent, can we reopen that and add this, what I believe is important improvement for the downtown, into that list, and then reapprove the list without losing any of the projects that we wanted to accomplish in that one-time Invest Ontario allocation. And because it needed to be reopened through a notice of motion, that is why the notice of motion is here, carefully explaining the whereases of the decisions made previously. And I ask council to consider reopening this, the budget that, now it says the $5 million was the downtown revitalization portion, because other elements of that total Invest Ontario funding are already in play. The work is being done. And there is a line item within that five that I believe that we can accomplish moving this John James realignment in and getting the job done. I'm here today as a mayor saying we need to take action when it makes sense to take action. And this, well, I can't speak to the rest of that unless we reopen it, and then I will come back. So I ask for a recorded vote to reopen. I know that I need a two-thirds vote, council. I ask for your support so that we can get this fund reopened, and you can see in the whereas that I believe this project could be funded from there, but that will be a subsequent decision. Are there any other speakers who want to speak to opening or not opening? There are none on the board. Mr. Clerk, I've asked for a recorded vote. There are nine members of council. I understand there was a need for six, at least, to reopen the matter.
Through you, Madam Mayor, yes, a recorded vote is requested. All those in favor of the notice of motion to reopen, please stand and be counted. Showing in the affirmative is Councillor Miles, Mayor Fennell, Councillor Hutton, Councillor Sprovieri, Councillor Dillon, Councillor Sanderson. All those against the reopening motion, please stand and be counted. Showing in the negative is Councillor Moore, Councillor Gibson, and Councillor Callahan. Madam Mayor, the required two-thirds has been achieved. The recorded vote is 6-3.
So we're now able to discuss that motion. Then I would like to, Council, if I may continue as the author of these series of decisions. First, let me say that we were all in receipt of the Downtown Development Corporation unequivocally saying they support the alternate alignment. So it is good for downtown, and the Downtown Business Development Corporation, our partners, have reaffirmed this is a good outcome for the downtown. So what I'm presenting now are two motions moved by myself and Councillor Sanderson. I ask for a recorded vote on each step. The first motion, speaking now to the opened Invest Ontario grant, I am asking that staff take the line item that was identified for the CN rail crossing. Part of the $5 million allocation was to improve the appearance of the CN rail crossing, something we've always wanted to do and didn't have funded. That specific project has not started. We still want to accomplish that project, but as a member of the GO board until it was defunct, The GO Transit is in the middle of investing in that crossing. We were successful in having them hold on their portion until we concluded the alignment of John and James Street. There's activity in the area that together we could make an improvement to the alignment of John and James that I think if we were designing today, we would certainly design. And today is the GO is waiting. They have to have an answer. And this is our opportunity today at the least cost to get an improvement to this very awkward crossing. As I said in the budget when I introduced the motion on the entire area of John, James, Scott, down through Mary, who would have envisioned intensification when these roads were first designed? Who would have envisioned the Legion would move across the street? Who would have envisioned Cardinal Leger School expanding its size? And who would have envisioned Cardinal Leger School student population being drawn from the north side of Queen Street? Pedestrian movements, increased traffic movements. There's a way to improve this intersection. We have GO standing by. There's an intensified site, which is exactly what we want, currently in the area. Today's the day for the least amount of money. The city can be a partner at getting this done. I was told it was approximately $1 million. There's a report on today's agenda, which we've referred forward. And so that if we agree today to reduce within this envelope the amount of money necessary to get John and James, then we'll be moving the John James project into the Invest Ontario allocation, reclose that decision, and then you can bring forward the report on John James if you're wanting to support the realignment. Well, we do have a motion here to realign with the alternate alignment, and then we now have the funds to do it. So we've reopened an account. We're reducing by about $1 million. We're putting a project in that's about $1 million, reclosing it in the Invest Ontario one-time funding, and council, we're getting a job done. We're making a motion and we're getting action to make a dramatic improvement to the road network in this area. I think it's very important. I know that there's been some discussions. It should come from this budget. It should come from that budget. The fact is we need to do lots of investment continually and ongoing in our downtown. And our budget, our 2010 budget, is now closed. So the opportunity to add it to this or that budget was during the 2010 budget. It did not get into the 2010 budget, so the mayor has tried to find a path to get the job done, to get the job done for the downtown, and the Downtown Business Association agrees the job should be done. So we can spend time saying it should come from here, it should come from there. The roads budget is closed. The roads budget is property taxes. Invest Ontario, one-time opportunity. Now, I want to congratulate Councillor Sanderson because he is a downtown, a very passionate supporter, and he asked me to put some words in, which I agree, and because this one account that hasn't yet started to be used for this underpass, there was murals, there was lighting, and there was some other design feature. We still get the murals, I'm told, but we will need the money for the lighting. And Councillor Sanderson has asked, and it's now part of the motion, if you approve these two motions, you will be approving that the money be earmarked in the 2011 budget to replace those funds so we do get the CN underpass prettied up. But if I, as mayor, have a choice between pretty and an improved roadway, I'm siding with the improved roadway. It's tough to make tough choices, but there's $5 million in this account. It was a way to get the job done. So, council, I ask for your support. I ask for a recorded vote, and that's why I ask that we open the fund. And you're really saying, of all the projects that were in that $5 million basket, can we add one more in? You can't make the fund any bigger. So it has to come from something. And quite frankly, we still have almost $1 million to improve these underpasses and money on deck if we approve it to get at that in next year's budget. So that's my request of council. as a person who's represented this area for 22 years. I think it's vitally important that this get done today. If you want this job done, then vote for this. If you want it done later, it will cost you a lot more money because the GO money is going to conclude with their interaction at that crossing with the rail. For us to come and do this alone, it'll go back into the list of all the nice to haves, but you can never get it done. So there's our funding opportunity. I know there are now three speakers on the board, so I will now take the speakers, and if there are questions about this, I'm happy to answer them, or questions of staff. I will start with Councillor Gibson, followed by Councillor Moore, followed by Councillor Callahan. Thank you. Oh, okay, sorry.
Am I on, Madam Mayor?
The clerk has just advised me that the motions, I was unable to put them in front of you until the matter was opened. So now you can, because I asked earlier, why don't we put all the motions so everyone can see them, but those are the rules. Councillor Gibson, you're on.
So we don't have a copy that we can distribute right now that can read this?
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
Okay. Well, I voted against reopening the question because I don't believe we're doing the right thing here. And I just want to clarify what the BDDC's views are on this. We had a lengthy meeting with the Downtown Business Association yesterday, and yes, they support this crossing being done. But in no way did they ever say at the expense of any other project in the downtown. Never. And if we'd like to bring Karen Campbell or David Harnsworth down, they can clarify that. I've also spoken to Mr. Cucciozzola about this, that I wish he had stayed on as a delegation, because in no way did Mr. Cucciozzola ever intend, when he brought this forward either, to be at the expense of any other project in the downtown. And yes, one of our downtown counselors is willing to, I better choose my words carefully here, they're willing to move or second this motion to go ahead, but there's three other counselors in this downtown that aren't. And we all represent the downtown too. So there's three of us, two of us that sit on the BDDC that don't want to touch that $5 million. I've heard a lot about this crossing, about safety of it. And we've asked the question before. I specifically asked our commissioner the questions in committee and council before about the safety of this crossing. And the answer we got back from staff was they felt it was a safe crossing, and so did CN. I'm not hearing a lot of words about the safety of it. I'm just hearing about the improvement of it today. If we truly believe, and the area councillor that's willing to second this truly believes that this is not a safe crossing and needs to be fixed, which I'm willing to go along with if he believes that it is, then we should be taking it out of a roads program. It should be at the top of the list if it's not safe on the roads program. That's all I've heard about lately, about the safety of it from people until we got today. I've heard there's been other meetings going on. I haven't been invited to other meetings, but it does affect the area that I represent and some of the work that was going to be done within this project. And I'm sure there's some staff out there that put a lot of work into a lot of the projects that are going to be done in the $5 million that was allotted. And the report that we had sent to us, memo report from Commissioner, I can't remember which one of the commissioners it was. I think it was